The teacher tells, the good teacher explains, the superior teacher demonstrates, the great teacher inspires. Welcome to An Academy, India's largest learning platform. An Academy is one of the best and fastest growing learning platform. It provides live sessions with the best educators. Believe me, the best educators of the country. Along with this, live practice questions with educators where you can practice different questions directly with the educators. Also, weekly quizzes and live doubt clearings where you can test yourself. Batch and courses for class 9 to 12 by top educators on the platforms where total syllabus is covered. The courses are available for almost all these subjects. Now, how to join an Academy subscription plan? Visit www.anacademy.com. What are the advantages of joining an academy? You get access to courseware from anywhere at any time. Combination of structure and freedom, effective time management, asynchronous discussions with classmates, immediate feedbacks on tests, preferred pace in learning, sample paper solving. And this is affordable for everyone. You can go to 1 month, 3 month, 6 month, or 12 month subscription. Use the code LE01 to get 10% discount. Welcome to An Academy. This is CBSE class 10th, social science. Most important questions for board exams. And these important questions are on the basis of repetition of the questions time and again in the board exams. The first one is, why had the Indian government put a barrier to foreign trade and foreign investment after independence? State any one reason. So what could have happened? The government would have allowed the foreign companies to just come in India, in the country, and set up their business. The likewise, the things which are going on now, like FDIs, foreign direct investment, etc. But the government choose not to do it. What is the reason? The Indian government put a barrier, that is a stoppage, to trade and foreign investment after independence to protect the producers within the country from foreign competition. Because when we got the independence, our farmers, our industries, they were just starting. That means because of the turmoil which we had for over 200 years because of the regime of British. So we were not very good or very advanced in the field of science or agriculture, industry, vinirman. So government choose to prosper or to allow them, the Indian industries, Indian farmers, to prosper and make the product or make their mark, so they are well enough equipped to compete with the foreign material or foreign goods. That's why they put the barrier. Why did Mahatma Gandhi ji decide to launch a nationwide satyagraha against the proposed Rowlatt Act? Explain any three reasons. So this question is also repeated again and again. Mahatma Gandhi ji decided to launch this nationwide satyagraha against the proposed Rowlatt Act. To trade, Rowlatt Act has been hurriedly passed through the Imperial Legislative Council despite the united opposition of the Indian members. That is, the Indian members, they don't want this act because this act was really difficult or dreadful for the people of the country, and especially those who are fighting for the independence and working for the poor. It gave the government enormous power to repress political activities. Any political activity or party which wants to ask questions or do something like protest or demand their rights to the government now has enormous power to repress them, oppress them. and allowed detention of political prisoners without trial for 2 years. So if someone is taken to jail or someone is detained, he or she can be imprisoned for or can be put behind the bars for 2 years without any trial, no trial whatsoever. So this was an unjust law for the country, for the people of the country, and especially those who are fighting for India to get independence and to get rights that they deserve. The struggle of the Nepali people is a source of inspiration to Democrats all over the world. Support the statement. Now, this is the struggle and which comes under the popular struggle. There are certain struggles all over the world, and some struggles are seen as the source of inspiration for others also. So the struggle of Nepali people is a source of inspiration to Democrats all over the world, all across the globe. The autocratic decision of King Gyanendra. So he took a decision in February 2015, which resulted in a protest by political parties. Actually, all the political parties, they came together along with lakhs of people on the street. So political parties, they have diverse ideology. They joined together, means political party one, political party two, they have different ideology. They also came together and they formed an alliance against the Gyanendra and defied the curfew. The leaders rejected the half-hearted concessions by the king, because after this happened, when first Gyanendra saw that people are coming and they are asking, people are coming on the street and the political parties have joined hand and they're asking for proper democracy. So he gave some sort of heel, you can say half-hearted concessions to them. But people of Nepal were not ready to take it. Ultimately, the king was compelled to concede all the three major demands which were made by the protesters. Therefore, the struggle of Nepalis is Nepalis, or you can say Nepal, is known as the second movement for democracy, because it became a source of inspiration to Democrats all over the world. Describe the conditions in which markets do not work in a fair manner. So the conditions in which the markets do not work in fair manner. First is when producers are few and powerful. Only few producers are there and they are quite powerful. So there is no one who is going to answer or question them, because if he does something to you, what will you do? He is so powerful. When consumers purchase in small amounts, if you just take very few amount, then the market will be unfair to you. Sometimes when consumers are scattered, if the consumer, you have been cheated by him, myself being cheated by him, or he has done some unfair practices with me and we don't know each other, we are scattered, and we even don't want to come together and fight against what he is doing, against his wrongdoing. When large companies have monopoly in production of goods, as they have huge wealth and can manipulate the market in various ways. So the big companies, big giant companies, they have, you know, crores of revenue. And sometimes the government also, they give a lot of chanda, etc. So government is also making policy such that this company is benefited. And even if something comes under light or suspicion that the company is doing something wrong, the nexus of these two institutions, they make it very difficult to make this company pay for what they are being doing. So because of the power and the monopoly and the money, sometimes the market do not work in fair manner. Passing on false information through media and other sources to attract consumers. Because what happens? There are marketing people. They want to sell. They want to sell product at any cost. They don't care whether the person who is involved or the consumer who is giving money, whether he is benefited or not. Okay, I'll give an example of a cream. This is a cream to become fairer. There is no cream like that. But people who are, because India is normally the wettish complexion people are here. So a lot of people, they buy this cream, and because they cannot say anyone that I have taken this cream to make myself fair. And this is how they cheat people. These company, they say in 7 days, you will be a white man. And this doesn't happen. In recent years, how our markets have been transformed. Explain with examples. This is also repeated multiple times. So transformation of our markets. There is a wide choice of goods now and services. Before us, if we go as a consumer to the market, we have for the same stuff, we have multiple options. There are option number one, option number two, option number three. So the latest models of digital cameras, mobile phones, television made by leading manufacturers, it may be LG, it may be Panasonic, it may be Toshiba, any name you take, they offer this of the world are within our reach. So not even the local brands, but all the international brands are in front of us with affordable prices. Every season, new model of automobiles can be seen on Indian roads. And the Indians are buying vehicles produced by the top companies of the world. Not even the automobiles, you can take any product whatsoever. So we see new model of mobile, automobiles or various other electronic gadgets and related items. A similar explosion of brands can be seen for many other goods, from the shirts to television to processed fruit juice. So as I was saying, you can take any item that as a consumer we use. We have seen that there is enough competition, and because of the competition and because of the demand of the consumer, we are able to get our products in very reasonable price and of good quality. Why is conservation of mineral resources essential? Explain any three methods to conserve them. So first of all, these minerals, let me tell you that they comes under non-renewable resources, but that doesn't mean they will not reproduce or they will not replenish, but it will take thousands, hundreds, thousands and lakhs of years for different type of minerals to be formed, and that will be a huge time. If I use it today, I have to wait these number of years to again get it back, or the prakriti or the nature to make it again. So the reason for conservation becomes very important. The strong dependence of industry and agriculture upon these minerals. The minerals are limited in number. They are limited in amount. We know it. And all the industries and agriculture, they in direct way or indirect way, they all are dependent on these minerals. So if we don't conserve them, how are our industry and agriculture going to run? The process of mineral formation is slow. As I just suggested, it will take years and years for any mineral to replenish, to come again, to be formed again. They are non-renewable. As I said, they are non-renewable. That doesn't mean that the nature cannot renew it. But the problem is, it will take years and years to make them. And what are there are other reasons also. I have just one more things to say. The first, they are exhaustible. Limited numbers are there. We know that they are limited. And minerals, they don't have just one use. See, if I make iron or an industry make iron, now this iron is not used directly, or it may be used directly, but it is used by all other industries. So this is actually a feeder industry. Iron is a feeder industry to all other industry. So these minerals have manifold uses. And the growth of industrialization has accelerated the extraction of minerals. Say X amount was extracted earlier. Now X to the power N is extracted now, because the industrialization is expanding. And how can we conserve it? We can conserve it by making an efficient use of them. The only thing is that you know that you have, say, 100 rupees in your pocket and you have to go for 30 days. So how to spend this judiciously? Spend 10 for one day, wait for 5 days, spend 10 another day. If you want, you can, in one day only, you can spend 100 rupees. Then what you are going to do for 29 other day? That is the same example you can take here. And using recyclable sources of energy whenever possible. And also, let me tell you, you can go for the ghair paramparagat sources, that is the renewable sources of energy. So let me come again and discuss again. That is, the method to conserve is, mineral should be used in planned, sustainable manner. That is, we don't want this to be finished by us. We want it for our kid. We want it for our kids, like this. Improved technology need to be constantly evolved to allow the use of low grade or at low cost. That means whatever minerals are there which we think that they are not usable, there needs to be some technology, because we all have technology in our mind. We can discover, we can invent. So these low grade and low, not generally used minerals should also be employed and used. Recycling of metal using scrap metals can be done, as we suggested here also. Recycling and reuse is always a good option. Wastage in the mining and processing should be minimized. See, if you buy any vegetable, see, it is say 1 kg. When your mother clears it for making food, it will be not more than 300 grams. Why? Because this 700 grams has gone for in cleaning. You cannot eat all the parts. There are some plus parts you have to remove. And this 700 gram is a wastage. So this exactly what I'm saying here is, when we do mining and processing, there is a lot of mineral wastage is there. Mineral wastage is there. And this mineral wastage has to be decreased. We need to minimize it, and we need to take care in a justifiable manner and in a planned manner. Describe any 5 major functions of political parties. If you take example of India, we have multiple parties. Some parties are national level parties, some parties are state level parties, and these parties only, when they win, they make the sarkar, the government at the state level, state government, and the central, that is the union government. So what are the major functions of these political parties? Like the BJPs we have, the Congress we have, ANC, the CPI we have, the Samajwadi Party, the all the other parties like this. So the functions of political parties is, first of all, they contest elections. Their main thing is to win elections and to get the office, hold of the office. They put forward policies and programs in terms of their manifesto or their vichar, that we are going to do this if you elect us. So they put for policies and programs. And parties play a decisive role in making laws, because party, once they are in power, they are making laws. Even if they are not in power, they are in opposition, they are influencing, because they may be the part of the legislature. So that is how they play a very decisive role in making laws. Parties form and run the government. So as I said, BJP, 2014, 2019, they won the election, and now they have made the Sarkar, central government is BJP, mainly BJP. So they form and run the government. Defeated party in the election play its role of opposition to the parties in power. Generally, what we see now, that the opposition has no role. But actually, our framers of constitution, they have decided that this will be our parliament, or you can say legislature, and here will be the Satta Paksh, that is the governing or governance or governing body, which is the government, and the others will be the opposition. So if the government does something here and there, the opposition always is to look after and to virodh, protest, and to show the government, tell the government what they are doing wrong. Their wrongdoings can be surfaced by the opposition. These parties shape public opinion. Now, when the BJP says that we will make Ram Mandir, or we'll say CAA and NRC will come with these. So that is what, when they came into election, this is what they said. So they actually made the public opinion. So whosoever in India, they want CAA, NRC and the Ram Mandir and others, they voted for BJP. Say Congress, INC, when they came in the election for 2019, they say we have a Nyay Yojana. That is Nyay Yojana, that some amount, say 5,000 rupees. This amount will be given per month to every individual. That is what the idea was. But people just disregarded that. They didn't accept that, and they chose BJP. This is how parties shape their public opinion. Means public are opinionated by what the parties offer them. But parties provide people access to government machinery and welfare schemes. So now, see, going to a bureaucrat, say an IAS, I cannot go to an IAS. It will be very difficult for me to meet the DM. But I can go to the corporator, local parshad. I can always go to him because he is my buddy. I know him. He is living just across my street. And then I can tell him that this is my problem, and now he can escalate. And it is always, you know, a like of brotherhood, and they can work for you. So this is how parties provide help to access the government machinery like this. and welfare schemes, any scheme being you can say government has given or announced, these people will help us to be in that scheme and take the advantage of that scheme. How do pressure groups and movement exert influence on politics? Explain with examples. So this has also come time and again. So pressure groups and movements, they exert influence on the politics in various ways. First is the pressure groups and the movements, they try to gain public support and sympathy for their goals and activities. For example, Project Tiger. I'm just taking an example. I don't know whether it is pressure group or movement, but if you take the Project Tiger, or you can say, let us take a proper one. That is the Narmada Bachao Andolan. Now this was a pressure group and a movement also. Now when it came, it actually gained support and sympathy for achieving that, whatever is happening, once that Sardar, Damodar Valley project was been done. So actually the NBA took the sympathy and support, and that is how people came to protest against. And once the dam was built, after that, whatever has to be compensated to them, it actually was done just because of the pressure from this NBA. They often organize protest activities, that is dharna, etc. And business group often employ professional lobbyists, that is the big people, that is it, Ambanis and Adanis. They will not go to the government and say, I want this or we want this. These Ambanis and Adanis are they have money like anything. So they will do what? They will hire some agent or lobbyist, and they will ask the government to do this, make policy according to them, or whatever, thing they want. Sometimes political parties grow out of movements. I'll take this first. Let me come here. The pressure group are either formed or led by the leaders and political parties. So all these, most of the Mazdoor unions, if you see Mazdoor Sangh, they all are having the backing of the major political parties. Even if you go to the college student union and different parties, they are backing these student or college unions or college, you can say the fronts. And political parties grow out of movements. We have seen this in Assam, we have seen this in Tamil Nadu, that the party which were fighting as a group or a pressure group movement. Let us take an example of Delhi also. We have seen that there was people organized against the corruption, and finally the Aam Aadmi Party was born. In most cases, the relationship between parties and pressure groups is not so direct. The place where the Indian National Congress session was held in 1920. So what is the name of that place? It is Kolkata. Calcutta at that time it was called. So this is the place. It's actually the capital of our state, West Bengal. Why is the supervision of the functioning of formal sources of loans necessary? See, there are different type of loans. Some from formal sector, some from informal sector. So these are kind of loans, formal and informal loans. Formal loans, let me give you an example. If you go to a landlord and take money, that is informal sector. Money lenders, your friend or anybody else, relatives, these are informal. But if you go to a bank, commercial or cooperative bank, or a bank which has some government backing or government sanctity, these are the formal sources. So the supervision of formal sources of loan is necessary. The reason being, so that the targeted people for whom specific loans have been designed can avail such loan. That is, if this loan has been approved for the farmers, the bank should not give the loan to anyone else, like the people who are already having money, or friend of bank manager. In order to check the creditworthiness of prospective clients to minimize default. So if anyone who is coming, there has to be some rules and regulation that has to be followed. Otherwise, everyone would come, take the loan, and he would vanish. So that the appropriate rate of interest are charged, that is, the rate of interest should not be more than what is prescribed, and there should not be any hidden charges. In order that the targeted economic activity get a boost, because this is loan is given only, or loan is the criteria of actually enhancing the economic activity. So that the banks and other lending institutions have adequate resources to meet their lending objectives. So these are the reason why the supervision is necessary for formal sectors. Now, question number 11, this we are going to take in the next discussion. Okay. Till then, thank you so much. Take care of yourself.